Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of Bullish's Top Stocks to Watch for the upcoming week, or the current week whenever you're watching it, or the past week whenever you're watching it, and why. I've been gone for a bit, but I am back. A couple friends just said, hey man, just get back into it. We kind of miss watching your shit. And honestly, you know, that's, I do it for fun. You know, I'm not doing it for anything else than that. So you know what? It's fun. Let me just jump back into it a little bit. I wasn't following the markets as much after that whole, Reddit, GME, AMC shit. That kind of, to me, broke the market. You know, it was fun doing it, but it kind of was, I was very hesitant with that shit after that. So, but you know what? Circling back to it, I still think it's a lot of frothiness going on. Inflation's going crazy. The T-bonds are fucking crazy right now. The shift between growth and value, valuations are coming into play. It's a whole different market. If you were making money last year, the same shit you did last year is not going to work this year. And it took me a couple months to kind of figure out really how I'm going to play the market. But anyways, before we get into it, a few different things to jump into. Hey, these are only my opinions. Do your own due diligence. I'm not a financial advisor. I'm just doing it for equal parts entertainment and education. Just to help out a little bit. But also, number two, hey, give us a sub here on YouTube. Help me feel good about myself. But also, follow real_bullish. Basically, you know, Twitter, I'm super active. Instagram sometimes. Reddit, not so much. But anyways, yeah, give us a sub there and let's talk some shit and stuff. All right, we're going to jump into it. I'm going over today. The ones I'm watching is Unity. I'm looking at Wynn Resorts. My boy's name's Wynn, so that's bodes well. And AMD, I'm going over those three right now. If you can see my screen right now, hopefully you can. If not, I'm kind of fucked. I like to jump into markets, but also since I'm really looking at tech because of the cool-off, I'm going to look at tech. QQQs, if you don't know, it's an index that mirrors tech pretty closely. And that's kind of how I like to watch tech. This little mezcal, a little lime, a little water on some ice. This is delicious. But as you can see, tech had a really, really interesting cool-off period, and you kind of saw that, though. If you were really watching it, you kind of knew what was going to happen. You see this hanging candle here signified a cool-off, and then you kind of almost see reversal down here with the doji, basically, this kind of really skinny candle, or this really long wick, but little candle body, another reversal here. But also, hey, it's similar to the top right here. It's not fucking rocket science. It's just fucking stock trading. If you're a technical trader or if you're a financial trader or whatever the fuck, you know, I try to be a combination of technical, but also fundamental. I want to find really good value in companies, but also I want the charts to look good too. I want both of those things. And usually they don't align. When they don't align, I don't get into it. That's just how I play it. But anyways, you kind of see it here in tech, and you see that fucking four, I'm looking at the week level right now. You see that 4 week fall off, but this was telling you that that was going to happen. Also, this told you that this was an area of support and resistance. Boom, here, you see this fucking candle. It's, you know, that's not too much, but this one that falls, it was a hanging doji almost, if that's a thing, you know, and it found support here, it broke under it, and now it's going to have to retest it here. What I like about this is this on the top is pretty bad. This on the bottom is generally pretty good. It's basically, you know, a hammer, right? And usually that signals a reversal. There's a few things here that I like. But anyways, this is why I'm looking at the queue specifically. I have two distinct tech companies as well. You know, I want to look at this. It's great to have a good company, but if the market for your company that you're looking at isn't in line, it's not going to fucking matter all that much. But anyways, we're going to jump into the first one. I'm talking about Unity Software. And then, you know, I like to think about things. I like to think about things at the month level and then break it down to the week and the day. I'm basically a swing trader. I really don't day trade. Although day trade, I have day traded before. It's a lot of fun, but I just don't have time for that shit on a daily basis unless it's something I really want to get into. But anyways, while I'm looking at Unity Software, Unity is mainly known for video game developer tools that power a large number of mobile apps. But they also plan to kind of do different verticals. The vertical is the industry, right? So they're in the basically video game vertical right now, but they're also going to, they plan on going into like construction, automotive companies, different verticals. They haven't got there yet. So right now their bread and butter is video games. They'd had some earnings, I think 2 or 3 weeks ago. And you know what? They had really good top and bottom beats. But they gave like shakier guidance, but that's kind of what Unity does, right? Unity kind of sets your expectations. They've been around for, you know, Unity has been around for not too long, but they kind of try to set expectations pretty low to beat those things. But anyways, they're a little expensive right now. They're trading at 22 forward year revenue, right? We're not even talking about, earnings. We're talking about revenue or sales right now. So they're a little bit expensive for what you're going to get, but that's kind of what the market is for these expensive. For these kind of expensive companies. And so you have to really take pause of that. Last year in 2020, what was last year? Yeah, 2020, valuation didn't matter. It didn't matter how much they were trading forward sales or forward earnings. This year, it does fucking matter for right now. So that's something to look at. 22 forward revenue is a little bit expensive, but not out of the ordinary. But I like that a lot of that money that they use, they put in research and development. So right now, they're really not worried about being profitable. They're worried about like being that industry leader. Not only are they industry leader, they made the fucking industry. But also, you know, they got $1.6 to $2 billion in the bank. So they have a lot of runway. They put all that money in research and development. They're a little expensive for where they are, but they are the industry leader, right? I think they, you know, compared to 2021, their growth has slowed, but still, I like that they're still growing. They have low debt, and a lot of that money they're putting back into themselves. Price targets, you know, are pretty mixed along the way after earnings. They have them into like the low mid hundreds. So right now, we're not even close to that, right? We're basically at, you know, 93 or in some change. So I like that. There's still some meat on the bones there for me. If you look at this, you know, in terms of the month level, I really like this bell curve. But what did I say about this hammer in the previous one? This is good at the bottom. It's not good at the top. If you're looking at the month level, we still got a whole week left worth of trading basically. But for right now, it's looking pretty good as a reversal play for a few different things. It hasn't been trading for a long time. It just IPO'd, you know, basically in September of last year. So we don't have a lot of time with that, but volume's coming in. I like how this, you know, the MACD is kind of like, it's still negative at the month level, but it takes a long time for month level indicators to kind of catch up to what it is. But when you look at it at the, oh, that's the 5-minute chart. I don't want that. If you look at it at the week level, which sometimes I do, like to look at, well, like I said, at, you know, month, week, whatever the case may be, I kind of step in it backwards and then go through forward in time. What I do like about that, hey, you have this indicator here where you have this kind of doji at the bottom at previous support. I did this on purpose because, hey, when the week it started trading, it was at basically 76, where it topped off for the week. Right here, or actually that's where it started and then where it ended up is different. But basically, that was a key area. What I wanted to do is wanted to hold that. If it broke that, I didn't know what I was going to really do with it, but it actually held that. So I've been in Unity for like a couple weeks now, basically when I saw it hold this doji candle right here. But what I like about it, you know, if you look at the RSI, it's kind of curving down. The MACD is also curving down. It had a really strong reversal signal here with the doji and all of that at a key area of support. And it's not too far from the 200 EMA, right? And then, you know, you saw that reversal come in. And this is probably, to me, honestly, if I wasn't playing it, I was playing it pretty risky, but, you know, and for a good reason. There's a lot of smart people saying really good things about Unity. David Packer, he came on to, pre-market prep. Dennis Dick was talking about it. Watch pre-market prep. It's a Benzinga show. It's really good. Basically, they were talking up Unity really, really big, you know, over the past 2 weeks. And I did take a look. When I looked at it, I really liked it as well. So kind of got into it there. But you see, hey, a reversal to a really strong green candle at the week level over the previous week. But if you break it down here, you do see the same kind of difference here at the day level. And I really, you know, there's still, I don't like to buy things. And this is my note for myself here that I put down there. Hey, I bought, you know, I sold it basically 520, right? So I sold it, you know, on Thursday because I didn't know what it was going to do at this level here. It tested it and it pulled back. And then it kind of broke out. So you know what I say, don't buy things in the middle. So you don't want to buy it here. You want to buy it here, or you want to buy it when it breaks here. So I sold it because I didn't know what it was going to do. Friday ended up breaking it. That's great. Great for you if you're still in it. What I'm going to do is see if it holds this area of resistance or the support here at 92.51 and then test to get back into it. I just didn't want to hold it again because tech is shaky. I buy in weakness and sell in strength. When shit starts ripping, I sell that shit. I don't buy when shit starts ripping. I buy when shit is breaking and I have a plan. If it breaks more, I'm going to either sell, you know, case for this one, if I would have bought, you know, I basically bought around here. If it would have broke this level of support, I was probably going to get out of it. You know, have a game plan for everything you do. But also the opposite of that, I could have kept on buying as it went down. I was just really shaky about tech in general, not Unity. Tech in general, but I still think that if it breaks here, that's a perfect opportunity. I want to see it sell off and I want to get another chance at the support level, honestly, but it doesn't look like that's the case because you see all the indicators going up. You see price action going up. You see it took a day for it to break this level of support here. And then you see RSI coming up. You see MACD coming up. I should have held on to this, but it never hurts to book your fucking profits. In this market, you really have to, like, in 2020, you can let shit ride easy. In this market, you don't want to let shit ride, in my opinion, because the market's just going to take it away again for you. All right, jumping into the next one, Wynn Resorts. This is a few different plays. To me, it's a reopening play. To me, it's a gambling, online gambling play. They just had a SPAC spinoff with WBET. So they're spinning off their digital asset a digital asset to be sports. So it's going to be like a Penn or a DraftKings, right? They're going to be a competitor, but they have hotels and casinos and shit. So you kind of get both of those reopening and stay at home shit. But yeah, that's how I'm looking at it. They have hotels, restaurants, casinos. They're in Vegas and online sports betting with their new WBET SPAC. Say what you want about SPACs. I think this is an interesting one specifically. The CEO said that basically the online sports betting is a $30 to $40 billion industry over the next few years, right? They had Q1 earnings, which were not good, but their analysts were expecting it not to be good. It was really not good, but still, it's a casino. You have to kind of, if you're playing this one, you're kind of playing it above when people think it's going to blow. But what I really liked about this was a lot of smart people really bullish about the industry in general. There's this podcast, a really good podcast. Watch it. It's called Dumb Money. Chris Camillo, I think his name is. It was like a month ago. They were talking about reopening plays specifically. But they were really bullish on casinos and restaurants. This one was a perfect one. Also, my boy Jimmy Chill, Jim Cramer, he's been giving this shit love over the past 2 or 3 weeks so hard. When I see really smart people that I respect in the industry kind of following those, I kind of jump soon to take a look on. I should do it a lot sooner. But hey, I came around to this one a couple weeks ago. I've been watching it for a little while. And you know what? I'm not a Vegas person. I don't like betting, but I want to go to Vegas when that shit opens up. They got that new stadium there for the Raiders. Ooh, I can't wait to go there. But anyways, let's take a look at the charts, why I like it on that aspect. Looking at the month level, different areas here is definitely in a downtrend for a long time. That's to be expected. But what I really liked about this at the month level, you know, it's making higher highs. Basically after, you know, let's say 420, 320 was basically when you see that COVID effect. But after that, they've been making substantially higher highs and higher lows. It's definitely in a month level and a bullish uptrend. You see that in the price action. When I talk about price action, I'm talking about the candles, but also you can see it in terms of like the RSI, which is an indicator that I love. It's, you know, it's definitely going up. You see reversals at 70 and 30. That's how you play it. Reversal area. Also with the MACD, it's pretty flattened out a little bit, curving up here. So I really like that at that level. So at the month level, there's nothing about this that is like, I would want to catch it closer to this 10 EMA for month levels, but it's still kind of curving up. All these indicators will align hopefully eventually, but at the month level, it's still kind of in a reactionary mode to COVID. But still, you know, that's how I want to see it. Like, this is how it should look, right? Boom, 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 boom. It, for the timelines right now, it's kind of the opposite, but it's kind of still has that COVID effect. Like I said, the month level, it takes some time for all the indicators to go back online because it's such a long time frame. But even at the week level, hey, higher lows and lower highs. Boom, low, 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 high. Well, that's a different one. High, 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 right? So it's on a bullish uptrend overall at the week level as well. What I like about these, I like to catch them right when they're about to cross this 10 EMA to be bullish at the week level. Because when you buy it, if I would have bought it here, I'd have been fucking pissed. I wouldn't have done it, but basically I would have caught it when it hit this 10 EMA and rode for a little while. I don't like catching when they're too far extended from this line because everything comes back to normal eventually. I like catching it like right here, you know, definitely not right here, but still also this is a doji. So it was selling off it. You know, it's kind of meandering in this channel area for the past, month and a half or so. Then you see some reversals here, which is really cool because then that paves way for that green candle that hits this 10 EMA and cools off. What I like also is there's no like super hard selling volume, right? This is the average volume. There's no like volume one way or the other that's super bearish, right? There's no, this isn't over this basically. And you still see the RSI kind of flat, the MACD kind of flat. It's just kind of going around. But I think that the catalyst for this is going to be reopenings, right? Motherfuckers this summer are going to wow the fuck out. I'm about to go get a drink right now, even though I'm drinking this. But motherfuckers about to party so fucking hard. And the great thing about casinos is they can charge whatever the fuck that they want when they're at capacity. That room suddenly from 150 suddenly becomes 200, 250 because they can do that shit. At the day level as well, what I really liked about this one, what I love is this, it had to, you see why I put this line here? Why, this is not magic, it's 120, right? It had to hold this 120 line because it was previous areas of support going back from 325. So I bought it when it started hitting this line. Every time it came down to this line, I bought a little bit more. And this market, I don't want to buy big because I don't know what's going to fucking happen. I like to buy smaller and longer over time. That wasn't what I did before. Before I would buy 100% of what I was going to buy that day. in small increments throughout that day. Now, I don't like that because the market could shift one way or the other, and I have to have enough cash. I'm basically 95% cash in my account, not margin, just my own money. I don't do margin, but I'm probably going to eventually, you know, at that level, right? Every time I hit this line here, boom, buy a little bit more, buy a little bit more, buy a little bit more. And now we're going to see, now I won't buy it because I want to see if it's going to break this level of resistance that we've had at 130. But a lot of people are really bullish about this. What I don't like is there's been no average coming in, but as to be expected, this is a fucking casino, but there, and you know, the volume is getting there, right? But I also like the RSIs coming up, the MACD's coming up. So I think that Wynn Resorts is going to be a really, really good one as a reopening play, but also as an online sports betting play. The last one I'm going to go through, we already talked about it, but I've talked about AMD so many fucking times. I love this company, but the market fucking hates this company because it's one of those tech winners. And you see, hey, I've been watching AMD for a while now, you know? But what I liked about AMD specifically, honestly, Dr. Lisa Su, the president and CEO, she's a bad motherfucker. Like, She fucked some shit up. They just announced a $4 billion buyback, I think, this past week. And that's kind of why you see a little bit with that pickup there. The market really hated its acquisition news of Xilinx. I think that's how you pronounce it. It's not closed yet. So anytime you have an acquisition and there's money involved with that and stocks and shares, you know, the market has to react to it. It's not closed yet. But once that closed, I think it's like the later part of this year, the second half of this year, we're going to see that shit. We're going to see a whole new level of fucking growth for AMD, I'm assuming. But also, you know, they're a product of the chip shortage, which also should be like supply and demand, right? The supply is low, the demand is high. So companies are coming online to produce those chips. So we have the chip shortage originally. So I think we'll see kind of, you know, definitely by the end of the year, kind of the tail end of that whole shit. But yeah, the charts honestly look super disgusting, but I think that they look disgusting and also it's sexy at the same time. But anyways, the reason why I like AMD, because I think it's honestly industry leader. Dr. Lisa Su is bad, but also that acquisition didn't help them. But what I like about AMD is it's been in this channel, right? It's no fucking secret. It was diving between 93, right? 94-ish. And this one right here, 74. It was playing in that channel. I'm looking at the month level, right? You see this clear channel here. It's hitting that. Catch it when it hits that low. Catch it. But what I like about this at the month level, it's really showing support at this 10 EMA here. There's been no months where it's like, oh shit, selling pressure is heavy as fuck, over average. There's been none of that. It is in a bit of a downtrend still with the RSI kind of. You see how like, usually when you get to 70, it's overbought, and there's a reversal. This thing ran to fucking 89.90 before it reversed. Your RSI can stay hot if it stays hot, but once it starts reversing, you better watch the fuck out, you know? MACD also looks like it wants to diverge to be bearish as well. So still at the month level, like I said, the charts are disgusting, but also disgusting and sexy at the same time. You know how you see that girl and you're like, or guy, and you're like, damn, she or he is nasty, but I like that. That's exactly what this motherfucker is to me, AMD. Like, damn, she's a little nasty, but damn, I like that shit. But anyways, at the channel level, you see this week right here, still kind of channeling at the week level. But what I love about this is once they announced that buyback, you see this shit was like, but also there was a lot of shit on there because it hit this 73.94, 74 bucks, I say, area of support. I put a fucking marker here. If it breaks below this, I'm buying everything I fucking can. It didn't get there. It didn't get right to where I wanted to, but it got to where I expected it to go before it reversed. So right here, you have a clear channel or a clear support here. It respected it, bounced off of this. You saw at the day level pressure coming in, right? But also what I loved about this, RSI was like, let me start reversing at the day level. And I expect if it continues this trend, week level, month level will kind of, you know, in line with the time frame, kind of reverse as well. RSI picked it up. MACD's coming up. So I liked, this is at the week level. But yeah, so I like that at the week level, right? It's like, boom. And if you look at the day level, even more sexy, disgusting and sexy. It wanted to break this channel, right? It wanted to go. And that's what I was looking at. And that's why I was like, oh, I can't wait for this shit to break. It just didn't end up breaking because they announced that $4 billion buyback. And you saw it, right? Basically 519, right? Was it 519? Yeah, 519. They had a buyback program in the earnings. So you know what I'm saying? Like that's what you see with it there. You never kind of really broke it for too long. But I like IMB, like I said. I think that they're still a lot of selling pressure for it. But I think that once, I mean, I wanted to come back to the 74 area so I could really start playing with it. Like I said, I don't like buying things when it already made the run. I want that money before. But I think that, you know, right here you have, you know, you do have a sign of maybe even wanting to reverse back down and kind of test this 74 area again. But no selling pressure over average has been here since basically 513. You see RSI does what look like it wants to reverse at the day level. MACD, it's a little bit mixed as MACD wants to kind of do the opposite of what RSI is doing. So you do see some kind of, you do see some disgustingness, but also there's some sexiness in that. So, all right, let me just go through it again. It was quick. You know, we got Unity, we got Wynn Resorts, we got AMG. Those are the three I was watching for last week. I'm definitely watching for this week, especially when they break those important areas of support and resistance. I appreciate y'all checking me out again all the time. You spent all of, what, that 15 minutes. I try to make these pretty short. I really appreciate it. So let me know what y'all think. Peace.